In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My Lord and my God, I firmly believe that you are here, that you see me, that you hear me. I adore you with profound reverence. I ask your pardon for my sins and the grace to spend this time of prayer fruitfully. My Immaculate Mother, Saint Joseph, my Father and Lord, my guardian angel, intercede for me. We continue our reading of Saint Matthew, our Lord moving around the Lake of Galilee. After the multiplication from Capharnaum, remember, they went to the next cove where the multiplication, the first multiplication of the loaves and fishes occurred. Sends off his disciples. They cross over and they experience that difficulty with the waves. And in the middle of the night, well, early in the morning, he comes across to them walking on the water. And then there was a second multiplication of the loaves and fishes. And then they went across to the land of Gerasa or Gadara. That's clear across the lake this time to the eastern side, and that's where that amazing, fantastic episode of the casting out of the demons from those two demoniacs who took over a herd of swine and caused them to hurl themselves into the lake and drown themselves. And that, shall we say, puzzling attitude of those pagans there to ask our Lord to leave their territory. They were not ready for that kind of message, for that radicalness. And now Saint Matthew continues, and getting into a boat, he crossed over and came to his own city, which means therefore he went back to Capharnaum. And behold, they brought to him a paralytic lying on his bed. Let's pause a bit. As always, we begin with the literal sense. What exactly happened there? This is the account of Saint Matthew, and in the parallel passage of Saint Mark, the brief evangelist, because Saint Mark's version of the gospel is the shortest, but he has a knack for, even if his versions are short, of putting in details which the others may have missed. And this time he does it again, because he puts a detail that helps us understand this scene better and explains why the text refers to their faith, because it says that Jesus marveled at their faith. We're told that there was such a crowd around Jesus that the people carrying the bed could not get near him. That's easy to understand. They were in a normal house. People had milled around the doorway. That could even have been the house of Saint Peter. Remember, he was there. That's where he would lodge when he was in Capharnaum. And it says, so they had the idea, the friends who were carrying the paralytic. The paralytic was not walking around, of course. No, he was on a stretcher, on a litter, and maybe four friends were carrying him around. So they had the idea of going up onto the roof and making a hole and lowering the bed down in front of Jesus. Again, we have to put ourselves in the proper environment. Contextualization is important in reading anything, historical books. In the Middle East, the houses are made with stone, stone upon stone. And how does that end? How do you make a roof then? They had not invented the arch. The Romans invented that. So mankind had always made roofs when you make walls of stone upon stone by putting logs or wood across it, just flat. Flat. How about the rain? It doesn't rain in that area, so they have flat roofs. More like a terrace, right? So they have terraces, logs, and perhaps even thatched with straw or any one of those palms. What for? To cool it down a bit. That's what happens here. They brought up, and by the way, that terrace normally is accessible. That's why outside the house, there are stairs going up so that you can go to the roof. That's where you do your laundry, or at least you do the wash. Sometimes that's even where the bathroom is. That explains the famous episode of King David observing Bathsheba in the neighboring house from the palace, because she was bathing on her roof, thinking that she had privacy. But in any case, don't get distracted with that. But this time, this bunch of friends brought their friends up through the outside stairs, parted some of the thatch roof, and lowered him. And behold, they brought to him a paralytic lying on his bed. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Take heart, my son, your sins are forgiven." And behold, some of the scribes said to themselves, "This man is blaspheming." But Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, "Why do you think evil in your hearts? For which is easier, to say, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Rise and walk'? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins," he then said to the paralytic, "Rise, take up your bed, and go home." And he rose and went home. And when the crowd saw it, they were afraid, and they glorified God who had given such authority to men. That's a literal sense. It happened that way. We only have to explain a little bit about the materiality of the roof, but everything else there is pretty straightforward. And now, the spiritual sense. Several things come into play here, the most important of which is the faith of the paralytic and his friends. What they did was extraordinary. To bring a paralytic to a man who definitely they heard had been working miracles, but to overcome the difficulties, the odds, to get through that crowd, first of all, to bring the man there literally. When was the last time you brought a sick relative or a sick friend, I don't know, to confession or to church or to be able to make a pilgrimage? Many times sick people suffer not because of the sickness in itself, but because of the isolation, because they're left aside. They're living in a very small world. They're confined to the four walls of their room because everybody else is having a life, forgetting that they're not dead yet. Once that really got me so deep when somebody said that. "Remember to visit me, Father. I'm not dead yet." Brothers and sisters, when some people talk about euthanasia, mercy killing, because really some people are begging to be put down like animals, remember, and the Holy Father said this, they're not really crying out because of the pain, period. They're not really crying out because, I don't know, they have lost any interest in life. They're crying out looking for compassion, looking for care. Who wants to die if he's having a relatively okay time? And that's what we need to do with the sick. That's what we need to do with the infirm. That's what we need to do with the elderly. We have to accompany them. Not forget that they're still alive. I'm not dead yet. Let's not wait for an elderly relative, a parent, for example, to say that, "I'm not dead yet," because if she gets to that point, we should cry because we had been thoughtless, because we had been selfish, because we had just enjoyed ourselves. Well, anyway, that's the first thing, first lesson. Second lesson is faith, because they were going there against all odds, not just out of compassion for their friends. They really believed that our Lord could do something. Again, when we apply the means in order to accomplish something difficult, of course, or perhaps even something that's seemingly impossible, humanly speaking, impossible. And that's what separates the man with faith and the man without, the man with hope and the man without. Because we have considered this in the past, that you only act for a reason. You only act if there's something, shall we say, feasible. To dream the impossible dream, that's hogwash. It's a nice song, but it doesn't stand up to intellectual investigation. Unless, of course, you interpret it in the sense that to dream what many people think is an impossible dream, because precisely I think it's possible. Because I believe, because I have hope. And so therefore I take it as something given that I only have to reach for. And so I reach out for it. What do you call a person who reaches out for something which is not there? It's a fool. It's like, just like that schizophrenic moving into the castles in the air. You only move into something you have constructed. First of all, you dream about it because it's something doable and you're going to construct it. Otherwise, they're pipe dreams. You're daydreaming. That's why daydreaming or dreaming by itself is such a useless activity. Get real. Carpe diem. Grasp the day. Take the bull by the horns on a daily basis. That's how we get things done. Not with pipe dreams. And much less by complaining and putting the blame on something or somebody else instead of doing something about it. Well, that's what the second lesson of that episode. Those people had faith. They knew Jesus Christ could do it. And so they were applying the means, going through the crowds, finding a way to make that paralytic present in front of our Lord, even going through the roof. And they had what was coming. Go. What did our Lord say? Because it's amazing what our Lord said, right? Take heart, my son, your sins are forgiven. Take heart, my son, your sins are forgiven. 8 words. And the Pharisees took fault at it. This man is blaspheming. Who can forgive sins except God? They didn't realize. That says exactly what our Lord was trying to say. The foundation of what he had just said, go home, your sins are forgiven, means he's God. Well, what they wanted him to say rather was, go take up your pallet and walk. But isn't that being God-like too? Who can cure a paralytic just like that with his words except God? In other words, as some Americans would say, same difference. But you know, the Pharisees are given to casuistry. Just as all these other people right now are attacking the Pope, given to casuistry. But at the bottom, it's the same thing. What they want to do, to save sinners or to cast them off? What they want to do, to look in search of the lost sheep, the one lost sheep, because the 99 are okay anyway, or condemn him to being lost? Bottom, do you want to take the gospel seriously? When our Lord said to offer one cheek when you are hit and one? Or is that just words? Nice rhetoric. Our Lord was thorough. And so he, of course, is not going to back down. Sometimes things have to be said strongly. We're not jello. Remember that Jesus Christ was the gentlest of souls. Learn from me, for I am meek and humble of heart. He was so gentle that even children approached him. But when it came to saying things strongly, he called the Pharisees, you brood of vipers. No, I'm sorry, the one who said that was John the Baptist. But he used similar terms for them too. You hypocrites. Or throughout the money changers and the merchants, that had converted the temple courtyard into a baklaran on a good Wednesday or on a good Sunday in Ilo Tempere. That's right now, I think they fixed it. Which is easier to say. Take up your pallet and walk, 8 words. Or rather, your sins are forgiven thee. Or take up your pallet and go home. Take up your pallet and go home. 7 words. But he used more words than that, actually. But that you may know that the Son of Man has power to forgive sins, then I tell you now, take up your pallet and go home. And he did. Our Lord, with the same effort, which is no effort at all, can cause the cure of a physical ailment, of a material need, and a physical one, or rather a spiritual one, a conversion, therefore. But he's the only one who can cause it. Those men had to bring their friends. Of course, they could have tried to bring their friend to an herbolaria somewhere. There are so many people who spend so much money in all kinds of, I don't know, trips, cures, magic potions, instruments, when they really have their back against the wall because a cancer is incurable or whatever other disease. Until finally, one day, they think of going to Lourdes or one of these places, shrines, go to the Holy Land, for example. And what happens is a conversion instead. Perhaps the disease progresses, although there are notable miracles too, but definitely the spiritual conversion happens. If we think clearly, my brothers and sisters, we should realize that the most important thing is to go to heaven. And there's a way of doing that. We have to die one way or another. Of course, God gave us a brain, I mean, an intellect, and gave us all these means so that we can prolong life and with good quality as much as possible, because there's a place for that too. There's a reason why our Lord made us material. Otherwise, if the whole idea is just to go to heaven, he should just have brought us to heaven in the first place, like the angels. But he wanted men with bodies who would enjoy a paradise before segueing to the eternal paradise. So there's nothing wrong with wanting to live well in this life, of wanting to be healthy, of trying to prolong it. But everything has measure. Everything has a limit. And sooner or later, we'll have to face our own mortality. That sooner or later we'll enter an age of what do you call this thing? Deterioration, physical deterioration, even mental deterioration. As a matter of fact, sometimes I think the reason why we have to go through a state of decrepitness is so that we really learn to be detached from this earth. Because can you imagine, while you're fit and enjoying life and with your full capabilities, you wouldn't want to leave it, right? But if you're already sickly and decrepit, yeah. And then you can say, okay, good. I've had a good run. This is enough. I want to go to the real deal. That's what happened with this paralytic. Not only was he cured physically, he was cured spiritually. What had been there in inchoate form, the faith in our Lord, also the friends, you can only imagine what happened after that. Those people became Christians. Of course, who else would become Christians if not the first witnesses of the miracles of our Lord? Again, you know, sometimes we need to be realistic in reading sacred scripture. The whole Roman Empire was evangelized. People were converted from all over. Charity is ordered. Who will get converted first? The Russians at that time? rus at that time was, of course, there. But let's say the Gauls, the Franks, the Visigoths, and all those other tribes, they will have their time. But first, the people of Palestine, first, the Jews themselves, first, the people of Capharnaum. Unfortunately, many of them resisted, but those who did not, and obviously that paralytic and his friends did not, they would have become converted. They would have been converted, rather. What a good lesson in the itinerary of faith, going through practical means. That's why this is a theme that has been repeated in the course of these meditations ever since the beginning of the pandemic, that this pandemic has become our Damascus, has become our Quo Vadis. It should have been, if you had been taking these meditations seriously, a confrontation with the living Christ, who is telling us, have no fear. In this world, you will have pressures, but have no fear. I have overcome the world. There are still people who are panicky. There are still people who are getting desperate. And I can understand that. I can get that. If you have a hand-to-mouth existence, if you don't have money enough for food to put on the table, if you know you can't even afford to stay home and be safe because you need to go out and put food on the table, then I can really see the dire straits. You're like that paralytic who will have to rely on the help of your friends. But even that, as we can see, they found a way. But you know what? Because I know who are the ones listening to these meditations. You must have access to the internet. You must have access to these platforms. In other words, many of you are not going to be in a hand-to-mouth existence. How have you been making use of this time gain because you don't have to go to work, because you don't have to face traffic? How have you been making use of this forced isolation, of staying home because of the quarantine? Has this really been a Damascus? Remember St. Paul, 3 days, blind, not knowing what to do, but praying and fasting, grappling with the truth, grappling with the revelation, the new revelation that was going to change his life. Is this your Quo Vadis, Peter, running out of Rome, fleeing and meeting the resurrected Christ along the Appian Way, who we innocently ask, where are you going, Lord? Quo Vadis, Domine? And our Lord tells him, I'm going to the city to be crucified because you refuse to. And poor Peter had another one of his conversions, the definitive one, because he turns around and sure enough is crucified upside down upon his request, because he said he was not worthy to be crucified like his master. My brothers and sisters, we are in the Rubicon of our life. This 2 years or three, or perhaps even before, it depends, that we're going through, determines the rest of our existence. Every day does. But how good it would be if it would be for us like that paralytic, that encounter with our Lord of seeming paralysis, but ending up not only in the recovery of our physical, our material resources, but more importantly, the recovery of our spiritual inheritance, a determination of our eternal destiny, because we realize that we're made for God, that God is in control, we're not, that what we need to do is to be in sync with his plans and to live our lives as he wants on a daily basis. And then his power will be shown. Go take up your pallet and walk. Be a saint. Sure, here in this life we're all sinners, but sinners in love with Jesus Christ, We're trying to be less and less of sinners every day, and wonder of wonders, making quite a headway. If you put your head to it, your heart to it, if you apply the means, if you take to heart all these meditations that we've been having all these days, so they're not just an exercise in feeling good, but in actual conversions, daily ones, then I assure you, at the end of this hiatus, when we go back to a really new normal, then maybe we can have the bagong lipunan that we used to sing about, the new society. Which, on the other hand, is the only rational reason why our Lord allowed this episode in the first place. In the absence of which, then it would really have been a bad joke on us. Well, it's our choice. The history of salvation, as we have been witnessing, especially if you go to the Sunday blogs where we deal a lot with the Old Testament history too, and you'll realize that, on the other hand, it's really full of that. It's unfortunate why salvation is taking so long, because of our hard-headedness. You have about 4 minutes left to end the prayer.